बड़े
Hola, hola, Talo.
वीडियो ऑन कर रहा था।
Please put yourself on mute, everyone. Hello all, thanks for joining in huge numbers. Good morning Ramna Garu, thanks for joining. I'm very thankful that it's very early. Looks like, is it 5:30 or what's the time there?
No, it's 7:30, a little better.
It's 7:30, a little better. Okay, fine, all right. Okay, thank you so much for giving us this time and explaining, offering to explain to us on serverless computing. So the students are all there, very excited to learn. This is a new term to us, actually, Ramna Garu. It's not very much popular yet in India, this term. So many of the students are looking forward to understand what this is exactly. So Preksha, over to you. A brief introduction about Ramna, and then we'll take it forward to with the class.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. So, good evening, students. So, we have an entrepreneur, tech evangelist for business problems, also a problem solver, critical thinker. Mr. Ramna is the founder of Encompass Business Solutions, a strategic IT consulting and custom application development company in Cleveland, Ohio. Ramana's passion for understanding business problems and providing relevant technology solutions helps him work closely with business leaderships and entrepreneurs and technology leaderships with equal ease in an effective manner. His passions for solving business problems using technology inspires him to do better at his job every day, every minute, and continues to be the primary driving force to become a passionate leader. He takes pride in developing solutions that bring about a better process, mitigate human errors, and improve the overall quality of life of anybody who directly or indirectly use the applications. And this is all a small gist about sir, and it's over to you, sir.
Thank you, Preksha, so much. Thank you, Anuradha. Those were some really good words that you have put in there. Absolutely an honor to be part of the Black Buck Engineers program and to be able to talk to you guys today about emerging technologies. As I was actually preparing this presentation, I realized what an uphill task this is to address students, especially in the ages of 18 to 20, which is what I hope you guys are all in that age, right? And my mom is a teacher for 25 years, actually, you know, she was teaching like 10th grade biology and everything. And one thing that she always told me was when she enters the class, for her, the most important thing is the guy in the last bench or the last ranker, how to make him understand or him or her understand, you know, what she's trying to say and everything. She always used to tell me, it's never the first grader. It's never the first five rankers that I'm really worried about. It's always that last person, because that is where, his success or her success is what is more important. So as I was preparing this presentation, I was wondering myself as a 18-year-old or a 19-year-old, what would I like to hear? What would I like to hear in a session like this where I'm giving 1 hour of my time? And then it struck me another thing that my English teacher always used to say in the class, that we used to have the attention span of a goldfish. I don't know how many of you know, but the attention span of a goldfish is just 5 seconds. Back then, I don't know if I really knew about this, but you know, it was 5 seconds. And I choose a profession where, because of this digitized brain that we have, the attention span of my customer is 2 seconds. You know, that means that a customer who comes visits your website, you get only 2 seconds or maybe 8 seconds, depending on the age group, before they can load the content, they can see what your website is about and everything. And that's the kind of world that we live in today. So anyways, going back, so today I have the uphill task of holding your attention for more than 5 seconds at least, you know, so that I am sure that, you know, I am able to say things here or convey the message or share information with you that would probably be helpful for you as you guys embark on your career and, you know, in your cloud journey. I'll first start off by sharing my screen here. Let me see this. 1 second. Are you guys able to see my screen?
Yes, we are able to see.
Okay. Just want to make sure you guys are seeing the right screen. So you guys are seeing emerging technologies, serverless computing. Is that what you are seeing on your screen?
We are seeing emerging technologies, the emerging technologies on the left side and serverless computing.
Yep. Okay, cool. Sounds good. Okay, so this is going to be the topic that I would be primarily touching base today would be about serverless computing. But before I do that, I wanted to take a minute here introducing myself so that I can give more relevance to where I come from and what I'm going to say today. You can see my name. Yes, I have all these names. I go by the name of Raman, Ramana, Ram, but my full name is like a typical South Indian. It is Venkata Ramana Rao Bhavaraju. And that's just me, not all my family members and my neighbors and everyone. So you can just, whenever I write my name, it always strikes me that when I first wrote my first program, it was to solve my name, you know, my problem. I still remember this was back in, I think it was 96 or 97. I didn't have a computer at home. One of my cousins had it and I used to go there. It was in Excel on the address bar. I used to write this if conditions, you know, trying to see how it works, you know, play around with my name by giving my name, entering my name and seeing if I can, you know, reverse it, if I can cut off some characters and everything. So that's how I got introduced into the world of computing. So Ramana Bhavaraju, I would like to call myself a developer at heart, but wearing a entrepreneur hat. You know, I still think of everything when I sit in front of my customer, when I deal with my kids, when a lot of things that I see the world is, okay, there is a complex problem. I need to give a simple solution. I need to underline the word simple because that's what developers do. They take a complex problem and provide simple solutions. Giving a complex solution is always easier, right? So that's what I try to define myself is I'm a developer. I am a problem solver, which inherently comes with the game. Being a developer, you are trying to solve problems. I believe in servant leadership. I run an organization called Encompass Business Solutions, where we are a tech consulting firm. You know, we help product startups, SMBs, enterprises in doing custom app development. Okay, so I work with a great team of developers, testers, UX designers, who keep me excited, who motivate me to do better at my job in leading them. I am a son, dad, husband, brother, friend, all the social roles that come along with my job, you know, and then I would also like to consider myself as a good mentor, not a tormentor, you know, and everything. But I think I have a good set of people that I interact with. I'm very passionate about students, interacting with students, you know, to be able to tell them what I have learned from my own journey and everything. And lastly, entrepreneur. So given that introduction, today I will be spending some time with you guys in explaining about primarily about serverless computing as an emerging technology. My goal here is not that after you are done with this 1 hour of session, 45 minutes, 1 hour of session, that you become an expert in serverless computing. Neither will there be a certification that you have passed serverless computing. Neither maybe there will not be a job that is guaranteed for you. But one thing I can assure you out of this is I will share all my experiences. What is the potential of serverless computing? How it can be used? At the same time, trying to share with you guys about my own career experiences, my own life experiences and everything as we embark on this route. Talking about emerging technologies, and by the way, this is a very interactive session. If you guys have to leave any comments or anything, please leave it in the chat window. And you know, as I am continuing my session, I'll read them and I'll try to answer them if any. So the key thing here is in case of emerging technologies and then, you know, to speak about emerging technologies, there are lots of them. You know, I know that at Black Buck Engineers, you know, we have identified a few of them and then, you know, started to address some of them. But I think primarily you guys have to understand what are emerging technologies and why do emerging technologies keep changing every year or every couple of years, depending on what is the way the digitization is happening in the world. You know, how are people perceiving newer problems? And as the progress happens, newer challenges come, and then, you know, how do we solve those challenges? So before we embark on to learning about serverless computing and everything, I want to get the definitions of some of these things right. Like you guys can see here, emerging technologies are technologies whose development, practical applications, or both are still largely unrealized. That's the key word. You know, that is where emerging technologies are always changing, is because they are always work in progress. You go to some sites where you see under construction, it's the same thing. You know, this is a always continuously, the emerging technologies are changing, how the problem solving has been done is changing. 10 years back, you used to have a sign in where you have to sign in with your username and password. Today, you have retina scan. And the future is going to be even more dynamic in terms of how you're going to approach the simple thing of signing into a website or a mobile app or whatever. Secondly, these technologies are new and often perceived as capable of changing the status quo. That's the second most important thing. It's always, like I was saying, right? It's always under construction, work in progress kind of a thing. You know, there is at no point of time you can say that, okay, this is it. You know, after this, we are done. No more changes are going to happen. If there is any one thing that is constant in the digitized world, it is change. Change will always be constantly there. You know, you need to keep on updating yourself. You know, you have to keep on seeing what are the newer ways that people are doing. You know, what is the businesses needing out there? You know, what is the future 5 years ahead of the game? And I think what this COVID has really explained to us, you know, what is really has come out there is this, you know, the digitization has fast forwarded by 5 years at least in every sector or every business that you see today. You can see the change that was fast forwarded by 5 years. Next, I just want to, before again, right, we'll talk about serverless computing, but serverless computing literally touches so many aspects of the other emerging technologies also. I just highlighted a few of them to bring you more relevance. You must have heard about almost all of them here. IoT, Internet of Things. There was one idea that I got before I started my business, which is, this was back in 2012 or 2013, when my wife always asked me to go to grocery shopping, you know, something that I really, really hate even now, and I used to hate even then. The grocery shopping that you do is a very repetitive task, right? It's the same bread, eggs, milk, you know, all those things that you keep buying the same thing from the same store every time. You know, I always used to think, why cannot my refrigerator figure it out? Like, okay, I'm running low on milk or bread or whatever it is, and then it can immediately put an order to the nearest store, and the nearest store can ship it out to my home. You know, all the missing pieces were already there, right? It's easy to ship to home, you know, and it's easy to create an order from the refrigerator, and all those things are part of the IoT system. It's a different thing. That idea never really came out. You know, I just did a MVP. I couldn't really push it through. And then Amazon came with Amazon Fresh and everything. But that just shows the extent to which a IoT, which is an emerging technology at that point, even today, it's constantly changing, that can solve real world problems like that, where instead of actually driving to some place, picking up food and everything, your refrigerator can directly talk to the server in a very serverless fashion. You know, similarly, your cars, you might be thinking that I am driving in my car, I have ultimate privacy, but you do not know that your car is constantly talking to the server, trying to provide terabytes, zettabytes of data as to how many times you press the gas pedal, how many times you applied your brakes, you know, if God forbid, if there is an accident, what has happened before that and everything, so that they can make better cars. Again, a augmented virtual reality, similar thing, you know, augmented virtual reality, the entire gamut of things that can be done is totally changing today. I actually wanted to do a presentation on augmented virtual reality, but due to time constraints, I couldn't. But given another opportunity, I would like to show augmented virtual reality. What are the, you know, the kind of features that you can build? What are the products that you can build? How the existing your restaurants to how do you do shopping? You know, the Oculus lens. How can you invite your friends and then try to do more of a virtual mall kind of a shopping and everything? Some really interesting stuff is happening on the AR, VR, blockchain. You know, gone are the days, I think, surely where if you buy a flight ticket or an, you know, railway ticket or something, you know, and, you know, you have to hold that card with you where you, when you embark on your, you know, train, you have to show your ticket, you, they verify your ticket. If you do not have a ticket, you know, you cannot board the, you know, train and everything. Blockchain solves lots of those problems by making a decentralized database that everybody of the stakeholders are accessing the same data, but nobody owns the data. They only own their own small piece of the data, but everybody is changing it in a very common way. Robotics, 3D printing, quantum computing, drones, wearable tech. If you really want to see how many of, how many emerging technologies are really out there, I'm going to share my screen here. Can you guys see this, what I'm showing here with respect to emerging technology roadmap? Anybody?
Yes, we can see.
Okay, so this is just a scratch of the surface, okay? This, if you guys are thinking that, okay, this is all I need to learn. No, this is just something that Gartner has put it out there, saying that these are some of the emerging technologies for 2020 to 2022. And because of COVID and everything, this has gone even further. And I just wanted to touch base on a few things here. You know, see each and every quadrant that you see here, right? Security wise, everything has changed, you know, right from biometric to, you know, how database auditing is being done, to DAST and, you know, cloud access security. So many things are changing in this one. Similarly, the digital workplace, you know, you don't need to be at work, you don't need to be in an office anymore. Like, see this conversation that we are having, you know, probably 10, 15 years back, this would have been an uphill task, you know, to even converse with anybody like this. Then came the IT automation, you know, the infrastructure as code, cloud testing tools, values stream management, and all those things that are changing. Just as simple as something called database, you know, database has been there for a good 20, 25, 30 years now, just in India, you know, where we started digitizing, you know, some of the important data and everything. But even on that, if you see, so many changes are happening. Similar to this, you know, the cloud infrastructure and this small thing that you guys are seeing here, right? This serverless computing is such a small speck, you know, in this entire gamut of emerging technologies that are out there. Okay. The, you know, so this can actually lay out the good foundation for you, like what is happening out there, what emerging technologies are, and just always think of these as something that is constantly changing, that is constantly improving to make our lives better and everything. Not sure. Okay, so I will go back to my presentation here. Okay, so this is what you guys must be feeling after having shown whatever I've shown until now. I know that in the audience, there could be these three kinds of people. One who will be like, oh man, this is too much for me to handle. I don't know where to go from here. The second one is, you know, totally lost. You know, this is, you know, I still have, I thought this is what I wanted to do. But now having seen this, you know, it's even more confusing. And the third kind of person who are the rarity in the community are going to be the people who get too excited about such things, right? Wow, the opportunity is huge. I can see how, you know, how I can lay out, you know, greater solutions, the greater problem solving skills that I can bring forth to solve some of these problems. So absolutely okay to be part of any of these three groups. I still belong to the first group in so many situations where I have to go in front of a client and then they come up with something as crazy as, okay, let's build a blockchain solution for airline, or they say, let's build an AR, VR for an e-commerce virtual mall, or they say, let's build this Oculus lens for veterans, you know, all the things, you know. So as long as you don't give up, and then as long as you know you are going to go through these phases of life where it's too much to handle, to the point where you get too excited about it, you should all be good. So serverless computing, I think finally we are here to talk about serverless computing. So what exactly is serverless? You know, the term serverless sounds at odds with what computers are all about, right? You know, servers are like a mandatory thing. What do you mean by serverless when you say that, okay, my application is not running on servers? Is that what it means? Or is my application running somewhere which has nothing to do with physical infrastructure, hardware, or anything? What does actually a serverless even mean? Let me tell you, serverless does not mean it is serverless. You know, that's the first thing you guys need to understand, is there are still servers. There are still servers that are out there that your applications and everything has to run. It's still called serverless because of a certain reason. But before we go there, we're talking about serverless. It's very important for you guys to understand the history of computing. Back in the day where, you know, hardware was very costly, you know, applications, in order to spin up your own website, you need to own the hardware, you know, or else, you know, you have to literally go to a place where you can, like a date, you know, today we call them as data centers and everything, but you have to go to a place where you can say that, okay, I need to run my site. Can you provide hardware? Or, you know, I'm going to pay you something, or you actually in your own home, you have to run your hardware. That is how computing has started back in the day, right? And just imagine the complexity that comes with it. A guy like you and me who has an idea, you know, that you want to just spin up something and see what the world feels about a Facebook, right, kind of a social media app, or you want to do something for your friend where you want to just create a website for him, how difficult it would have been at that point of time where you have to create your servers, install the operating system, make sure it's always running, power cuts, you have to handle those, make sure your website, you know, as new changes are being rolled out, your website is intact and everything. So that is how this entire computing journey has started. Then fast forward came cloud computing. In the middle, there were a lot of other things, but cloud computing actually opened the horizon of opportunities, right? Where all of a sudden people were like, okay, I'm an organization, I'm a startup, I'm an individual, but I don't need to do anything on my own hardware. I don't need to have my own hardware. I don't need to have my own server. I don't need to install the operating system. I don't need to install the Windows patches and everything that come with it, right? So at that point, what is happening? You know, somebody else is doing that for me. Somebody else is doing where they are saying, okay, I got this server for you and everything. You can install your application within a span of minutes to hours or days. And then, you know, you are up there and then your application is already running. So what does that open up for you? You know, the key thing that opens up there is your application, your idea that you have, you know, you want to spin up your idea. You are not bogged by all this hardware related, the network issues, the security, the Windows patches and everything. And you can actually write code immediately and then you were able to deploy it. But with cloud computing came the biggest factor, at least, you know, 5 years, 4 years back, people were talking about the cost that comes with it. Once you say somebody else is doing it for you, what it means is, okay, you know, they are going to charge you. They're going to charge you if your application is running for the entire year, they're going to charge you for the entire year. You know, even if people are using it or not or nothing, they don't care about it. A certain servers or a certain memory footprint and you know, certain infrastructure, you know, peripherals and everything are set aside for you. So they will charge you for those. So then that still left all the people like you and me, startups, smaller businesses, everybody out of that gamut. Okay, how do we deploy? How do we make use of cloud and all the advantages that come with cloud? That is where serverless technology has really helped people, where it has changed the entire game in terms of, if you want to deploy your application, you want to test out your idea, you want to have a solution out there where you don't need to pay for each and every hour of that application that is running out there, and you want to actually only pay for when it is being used. Okay, if somebody is coming to my site and then hitting my application, only for that millisecond is what I'm going to pay. If the site is running 24/7, 365 days, it doesn't really matter. You know, it's all about how do you architecture your solution in a serverless fashion, and you are only paying for that minutest of that millisecond. So what does it mean? You know, like, okay, so there are no servers. Obviously, that's pretty much clear. The servers that we are not owning, the servers are running in the cloud. Somebody else is owning them. So what does it mean? Who is owning these servers? You know, how do we go about putting my application onto those servers? I have a great idea, or my friend asked me to create a website for him, or you know, I want to test out my idea with social media app, or I want to build a mobile app and I want to put it out there so that people can test it out. Okay, how do we still go about it, and who is owning these servers, and whom am I paying, and how do I go about it? The public cloud providers, you know, I hope you guys know, like, there are like public cloud providers, there are private cloud, and then there is hybrid cloud. The public cloud providers are the Amazons of the world, the Microsoft, IBM, Google. You know, these are all the public cloud providers where they provide all the infrastructure for you to prepare your cloud applications. Okay. Just one second. Yes. Sorry, just one moment. Okay. Okay, so these public cloud providers, the key thing that you guys have to understand here is they are the ones that we are eventually going to pay our bills. Okay, so it's very important that, you know, you understand that there are still servers that they are maintaining. They still charge you for, you know, however long your code is running. Like, for example, let me give you a very typical example here where, okay, I basically created an app where you can send messages to your friends. You know, there is a front end to the app, okay, and then there's a back end, right? The back end is the one that takes care of actually sending messages to your friends and everything. That's that sending messages part, that functionality or that app doesn't need to be running all the time, right? Because I don't know if 100 people today will use it, 1,000, 10,000 will use it, I don't know. So if I develop this app in a very serverless fashion, where I'm going to say that this app is going to run in a serverless architecture, what happens is at that point, I am only going to pay whenever my app is being used. That functionality, that part of the code that actually sends messages, it is running on a server. It is still being maintained by Google or Amazon or someone, but I'm paying only when that code runs, right? So that is the key factor that you have to understand when it comes to serverless technologies, is the code, the time, the time slicing that happens, the payment that you guys are due are to that millisecond. Actually, as I was going through, I realized that there were a couple of polls that I wanted to run. I completely forgot about it. And I wanted to take a minute here. Just give me one second. Um, Okay, I want to see if we can run probably the poll number 3, which is about cloud computing models. Riksha, would be that would that be you who would be running the poll?
I can run the poll, Ramana. I'm running it right now.
Sorry, I totally forgot about this, you know, as I was going through this. Can you run poll number 3?
Yes, yeah. I'm launching the poll, guys. Try to answer the best. Which of these are cloud computing models?
Okay, I will give another 10 seconds here before I end the poll.
Okay, I'm ending the poll. Okay. And that's the results.
Okay, perfect. This is really good. Really good. 67%. So whoever has answered all of them, that is the right one. The reason why this poll is important is because the next slides that I'm going to talk about, it's very important that I know how many of you understand IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, and some of these. I should have asked this a couple of slides back, but good that I remembered this at least now.
Usually answer the questions in the end, but there's some basic questions. Some of these students are even from the first years. So in probably in a minute, if you can tell them what a server is in the first place.
What is what?
What a server. Server is in the first place.
Oh, okay. Okay. Good to know. Yep. I will be closing this. Okay. So I think probably I should spend some more time on this slide here, which is owning the physical hardware. A server is primarily, how do I define this? A server is a piece of hardware, or you can say that it is the entire plumbing that you need to run your application, right? A server includes an operating system. It could be Linux, it could be Windows, it could be any other operating system out there that is needed for your application to run. Okay, server could mean a lot of peripherals that come along with it. You know, the server itself could need a web server running on it, like for example IIS or Apache server, all the software that goes for your application to run on it. And then comes all the peripherals. If your server needs to talk to a remote file management system out there, it has to write files to those remote file management system. It needs a certain kind of hardware, and depending on if you're in the healthcare sector, it needs an HIPAA compliant file management system out there and things like that, right? So server means all these things that are needed for an application to run. And these could change.
Tell them in one simple example, because they are first years and probably will not understand the complex things that you have just told. So students, it's just like this. You use Instagram every day, right? You post lot of pictures, lot of videos. You see lot of videos in YouTube or the audio files in Spotify. Where are they? Where are they stored? Do you know where they are stored? They are not stored in your PC. They are stored elsewhere. Okay, so that is what it is. It is like servers. It is stored somewhere else. As the complexity and the number of files increase, and Instagram, how much you have to store every day. You know, that's what the server takes care in simple terms. As otherwise, as Sir has just mentioned, it has many other functionalities other than just storing, right? So from this, we will take it forward with Sir again.
Thank you, Anuradha. Thank you so much. Sorry, you know, this is something that I face even with my kids. I have my son who is 13 years old and my daughter who is 10. It's so easy for me to converse with my son sometimes, because when I teach him math or something, I can tell him like, dude, you know, x plus 10 is equal to 5. So, you know, x is equal to 5. My son, he immediately gets it. Once I put x for my daughter, she's like, why are you using alphabets in math? You know, so I'm sorry, you know, that maybe I was speaking at a very higher level. I will try to see as I'm reading these chat messages now. I think, you know, I can better understand, you know, and then I'll try to talk more with the chat messages. Okay, so having said that, I'm going to repeat this one more time. So servers are initially owned by individuals or by organizations. An organization out there that needs to have a financial application or a Facebook application or a healthcare application or whatever it is, you need various servers to run your application. Now just imagine, why do we need servers? Is one of you guys is building your own website, you know, abc.com, and you think that, okay, my website, every day 1,000 people are going to come to my website, and then you prepare one server for that. You know, you will think that, okay, I would probably need a 8 GB RAM, you know, I need a Windows operating system or a Linux operating system. You build your entire website and then you make your website hosted on that server. Now, just imagine at that point of time, it's not 1,000 people who have it. They loved your website and 10,000 people started hitting your website. What's going to happen? Obviously, the server cannot take that kind of a load. And that is when you sometimes when you go to certain websites or apps, you'll see that it's loading slow. And you just move away from it, right? You never go back to that site again, okay? Just imagine the same thing now shifted towards Netflix. Somebody like Netflix whom, you know, people in the USA are looking at it, people in India, everywhere across the world, they are streaming those movies and then you are watching it from your phones and laptops. Now just imagine the architect or, those companies, what they should be going through in terms of preparing these servers. They have no clue whether a particular movie that got released today will be watched by 1,000, 100,000, million, billion people. They have no clue at all, right? So now they have to prepare their servers in such a way that it can handle those loads and everything. Okay, I hope I am able to say this the right way this time. So in order to think about all those things, you know, in order to have a vision about how do I maintain my servers and everything? Initially, from the time where individuals were holding onto the servers, preparing those servers, the infrastructure that goes in everything, then it went to cloud computing where everything is prepared by these organizations, the public cloud providers, right? The Amazon, Microsoft, IBM, Oracle, you know, every one of these public cloud providers. It's almost like going and buying a laptop, right? You tell, okay, you know, I want to put my application out there and I would need a Windows server. I need this much of RAM, this much of hard disk space, you know, and this much of, time that it has to be running and everything. And then they will send you a bill saying that, okay, you need to pay $30 a month or $50 a month or whatever, right? So that is what cloud computing is. And within that cloud computing model, you know, the poll that we just now ran, right, the infrastructure as code, infrastructure as a service, and then, you know, we have software as a service, and these are different models in the same cloud computing, which is probably something that I'll be discussing soon. Okay, so having said that, what is serverless is you are only preparing your application at that point. You know, you are only writing your code, you're only writing your website. You don't even care whether your website will run on Linux or it will run on Windows or anything like that, right? You're only writing your website code, or you're only preparing your application that has to be run on some server somewhere, but you would never ever care about where, which hardware, which infrastructure is it going to run, okay? So that is where serverless is. Serverless is, it's a step ahead of that infrastructure that you are maintaining to the infrastructure that the public cloud providers are maintaining. You're taking one step ahead and say that I don't even care what kind of servers these are and everything, but the only thing that I do care is only if my code is running, only the time that my code is actually getting executed, I'm going to pay the bill only for that point of time. Unlike the cloud computing portion that I was telling before, where if your website is running, irrespective of whether somebody is hitting the website or not, you are still paying the bill for it. If your website is running for 1 year, you pay the bill for 1 year. If it runs for a month, you pay for the month. But if your website is out there, it's deployed, and nobody is coming to your website and hitting your website and downloading the content onto their phone or laptop, wherever it is, then you don't pay. That is what serverless means. Serverless, just understand this, like serverless, there is a server still, you don't see that server. Your application is still running on some server. Anuradha, do you think that's a, you know, I was able to convey them?
Yes, Ramna, yes.
Okay, so I will go here to the next one. So this is what, right? See this, have the attention towards the pricing of Amazon. So Amazon is saying that 1 million requests are free, right? What does it mean? That means that you are building your website or your mobile application or something, and you put it out there in a serverless architecture. That's the most important. In a serverless architecture, if you put it out there, the first million hits that your website gets, you don't pay even a single penny. That, and after that, the next million requests, it is just 2 cents. You know, see the opportunity that opens up when a serverless architecture like this is built. You know, you are a startup, you are an individual, you just wanted to create a small idea and see, test it out, or you are preparing a huge application where there is a small piece of it that you don't know if 1,000 people will hit it, or 10,000 or million people will hit it, and you don't want to pay all the money upfront by saying that, yes, I want to run this application on this huge infrastructure that I will always plan ahead of the game, you know, and pay more. I don't want to do that. I want to put in a serverless architecture where if new servers are needed, if more load is there, and then, you know, they have to spin up new servers, somebody else is taking care of it, right? Somebody else is doing that job for you. Okay. So again, right, some of the things that I'm going to tell here are, what I've been trying to say until now, but I'm going to put it more as the benefits, you know, pay for what you use, right? There is no ideal CPU time anymore. What does it mean? If your code is running and somebody is actually using your code or hitting your code, you only pay for that millisecond. You are not going to pay for the entire time that your application is running. It's only for the time it's being used is what you're paying. Next, the developers. We as developers, we don't need to think about, okay, is my application going to run on Linux or Windows or Mac or wherever it is? I don't care. I know my application is this. I am going to write my piece of logic here, and that application can run on whichever server, wherever in the world. It is not my concern at all. Okay. These are some of the benefits, right? Then increase in productivity. Obviously, right? If I am not thinking about servers, if I am not thinking about, where my code is going to run, you know, which country is it going to run, and all those things, obviously my productivity will be higher. Then comes the next one, the products to market faster. When you are only thinking about, you know, my application, how soon I can get it out there, obviously more and more products can be built, more and more solutions can be built. Your own website or your mobile application or your social media application, whatever it is, you can release it much more faster. obviously, with all this comes innovation, right? Because your thinking process is faster, you are able to release products faster and everything. Obviously, the innovation aspect of it is also going to be much, much more faster than, you know, what you're going to normally do in a cloud computing world. Okay. So I have a question here. I'm going to take a little bit of time and try to see if I can answer some of these chat questions. I'll go from the last. Somebody is saying, who is going to pay, sir? Yep. So who is going to pay? It is still you. You know, you are still responsible to pay. But see how low you're going to pay. You know, you can test your idea and everything. I have never seen, at least I'll come and I'll show you what are the, you know, how do you prepare your serverless architecture. But we have done some huge applications, e-commerce sites, you know, where at least we have 10,000 users hitting the site and everything. And the bills that we are paying are less than $100. You know, it's amazing how this serverless technology, as long as you architect in the right way, you can use it so that your bills and everything are so low, and especially useful for startup community and, you know, individuals who want to test out ideas without breaking their bank. Okay, then can you mention an example on serverless? I will, as I'm going through the further slides, I will surely mention how serverless can be used and what kind of applications can be built on serverless. Okay, and so the person who is storing this. It is used by the person who is having the application. You know, the question here is, who is paying for it? Is it the person who uses the application or who is storing the data in a serverless cloud? It depends on your application, right? So for example, let's assume you're building a social media app. Okay, you are the next Facebook app that you're building and you host it on to a serverless architecture. So you still pay the bills, obviously, you know, because your application is running. If you're a good businessman, based on how you do your subscriptions and everything, you can obviously, you can charge some of that cost towards your customers, right? You know, for example, if you're building an app where you're selling something, you know, you're building an e-commerce site where you're selling cricket bats and cricket, gloves and all those things, right? So your application can be running in a serverless architecture, but your customers that you're going to charge, you have to have a plan ahead of the game. Like, okay, you know, I might, if 1,000 people hit my website, I'm going to pay $10. So obviously you have to plan it out in such a way that you are able to recoup some of that money and you have to charge your end customer, right? So there are multiple, payment kind of ways, like subscriptions based payment, or, you know, you can, depending on your application, you can charge them for a certain time. I think some of the games, they charge you based on how much time you have used that game and everything. So you can still do it that way. Okay. And I have a few more questions here. Google own its own servers. Great question. Yes, Google owns its own servers, but obviously if Google is going to have a data center in Timbuktu or in West Africa somewhere, you know, they have to lease, right? Lease those buildings, you know, certain, Google has their own standards of, okay, this is how our data centers are going to be. So the actual physical space, they might be leasing it from some other companies, but they will be setting up their own servers, bringing in all the infrastructure that is related to the servers and everything by themselves. And they are still responsible to maintain it, right? Which is why when you go to Google or Azure, Microsoft or Amazon, and when you want to spin up your applications, it'll ask you, where do you want your applications to run, right? Is it in South India? Is it in East India? Or is it in the US? Where do you want your application to run and everything, so that you can, your application is replicated in those regions so that they can easily access your applications in a much more faster way. Okay, so I will go to the next slide here. One thing that I wanted to bring here before I go to this slide is, I kind of assume that maybe, you know, a lot of you guys would know these terms. So I just want to spend some time here and explaining about what in here, right? When I go back, the cloud computing model, when I said this, there are three major cloud computing models out there: infrastructure as a service, software as a service, and platform as a service. You need to understand these three terms in a very clear way. So the best analogy I can give you is, you guys want to build your own, so you guys want to stay somewhere, okay? You want to stay in a home, okay? So the best way to tell about these three computing models is, in case of an infrastructure as a service, okay, you are building your own home. That means you are buying all the equipment that is needed. You know, you have to build it, everything by yourself. You have to put the first brick there. You have to bring, you know, you have to bring all the concrete, the cement and everything. You have to put your plan. You have to know how much of concrete is needed, how much of sand is needed and everything. You need to have a good plan to do this. Okay. That is what infrastructure as a service computing model means. You are building your own servers. You need to understand what operating system you need. What is the, you know, the hard disk space that you need? What is the memory that you need? You need to maintain the upgrades. It's all on you. You are building your own home. That is what infrastructure as a service means. The next one is platform as a service, right? In a platform as a service, right, it's almost like the house is being built by, you know, I mean, you are only going to bring the tools that are needed, right? So you have to probably pay, and then you're going to give the contract of building the house to someone, but you are only going to pay for, okay, go build this house for me, and then I'm going to pay you X amount of money. Yes, I will provide you the sand and the brick and everything, but I'll only pay you the money. I don't know how you're going to build it. I have no clue what is the, you know, the blueprint of the this thing. Yes, but at every point of time, I'm going to approve, I'm going to approve what is needed for the house to be built, right? That is the portion which is platform as a service, right? In a platform as a service, what is basically happening there is you have your application and you are only saying that, yes, these are the different tools in the cloud computing model that I'm going to use. Yes, I am going to use your database. Yes, I am going to use your security systems. Yes, I am going to use, for example, your logging or your, you know, things like that, right? All the plumbing that goes in building your application, these cloud providers are actually giving you that, okay? So they are the ones, but you are still paying money, okay? You are still paying money for those, and that is the part where it all comes under the PaaS side of things. The third one, which is software as a service. The software as a service is you are paying for the end game. You know, you are paying for the end result of the solution. Okay. Like, for example, one of the biggest software as a service companies out there is Salesforce. Okay. Not sure if you guys have heard about it. Salesforce is an application where you can maintain your customer contacts, your business deals, your documents and everything. They have built an entire solution as a software as a service, and you are going to use their service. That means somebody has built the house for you. Somebody has already put everything, and then now they are selling you that apartment, right? You just pay for it. You cannot make any more changes. You don't go in there and say that, okay, you built this apartment, but change this bedroom from here to there, or I wish, you know, this was like this. No, you don't get any of those things. Software as a service is the final product that you are going to pay for, and then, you know, whatever features that you will use, you will just pay for it. Okay, so these three computing models are very important for you to understand when you are embarking on the cloud computing journey: IaaS, infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. You know, the three major portions that go into a computing model. Okay, having said that, so now most of you might be confused here, like, wait a second, how is PaaS different from serverless, right? It almost sounded similar where, okay, I don't care about the servers, I don't care about how you are building them, but I'm still providing you the tools on how to build it. I'm still paying for that. So how is that actually different from serverless? Okay, so this is a very important question for you to understand. PaaS or platform as a service, like I said, right? For example, let's assume Amazon. On Amazon, you can have variety of databases, right? You can have an Oracle database or a SQL Server database or a Postgres database, Mongo database, different databases that you can use Amazon or Microsoft or something. Now in a PaaS, you are saying, I am going to use this database and I want a 50 GB database to be built it out. I need this to be replicated in Mumbai and Hyderabad because that's where most of my customers are coming. So I want one in North India and one in South India. I don't know about, the data centers there, but, have two different data centers where I want my database to be there. So that if somebody is in the northern part of India and they are trying to access my application, it is hitting the database server, which is in the northern part of India, versus somebody who is probably in the South India, they are hitting the servers in the South India, right? I'm still doing all those in PaaS. I'm telling where it has to run. I'm still telling, how much of, usage I'm going to do. So I'm still, there is the house there, but I want to use that house, but I can still provide all the tools that are needed in order to build that house. Okay, somebody else is building it for me. In this case, Amazon's and the Google's are building it for me, but I'm still telling what I want and what I don't want. That's what PaaS is, right? The biggest disadvantage of PaaS when compared to serverless is, in PaaS, right, you're still paying for however long that server is running, which is what I was initially telling you about, right? You are still paying. If you say that I want a database 50 GB and I want to use it, irrespective of whether somebody is hitting that server and pulling the data from the server or not, you're still paying money all the time, right? And if you told that your server is 50 GB and by mistake, if the data is so huge that it's crossing 50 GB, your server will come down, automatically, right? There is only certain portion that you can program where you can say that if it is 50 GB, then, spin up new servers, but it's still something that you have to program and you have to tell upfront as to how that has to work, right? That is the PaaS side of things, that you still have to tell how the scaling should work, how the auto scaling should work and everything. And like I said, bill, you are still paying the full bill for however time your entire database is out there. Anybody is using it, doesn't matter. Anybody is, how are they using it? How much data are they pulling? Nothing matters. You are still paying for that entire money. Compare that to serverless, right? Now you are saying that, no, I do not want it that way. I wanted to put it in more of a serverless fashion. You never ever will tell how much of scaling should happen. It's already being taken care of. If 1,000 people are hitting your database, that cloud infrastructure, that Amazons and Googles and everybody, they know that, okay, they need to have one server there. Once the number of people that are hitting your database or your app or something increases, they will automatically spin it up with new servers. You don't need to tell anything to them. They know exactly what servers to spin more, how much they should use more, when they should not use your application and everything. They make the decisions for you because you bought the apartment. You basically are basically telling that, okay, this is the portion that I want you to run. I don't care about anything about the servers or anything. You guys take care of that portion and I'm going to pay you only for the time when these servers or when my application is actually being run. Okay. So that's the key thing that you guys have to understand between serverless and PaaS. And I would really suggest you guys to spend some time today after this session is over to read a little bit more on those three computing models, IaaS, PaaS and SaaS, and then compare it with serverless so that you can get a good reference as to there's a small change in being serverless, but it brings about a huge opportunities and how you can do serverless computing and everything. Somebody was asking me about some examples here. I'm going to probably do this and share a few examples of serverless. Okay. Just one second. Okay. I know that this might be too complicated, but I try to explain to you in terms of use cases. Can you guys see my screen? I'm showing you the Amazon site. Okay. I hope you will. Okay. So here, right, this is a to-do app, right? A very simple app where you want to keep track of what are the things that you want to do in that day, right? You are probably building a calendar application and you want to keep track of, okay, these are the things that I want to do and everything. Okay. Just ignore all the things on the left-hand side here. Now just imagine what they have done here, right? Your to-do app has multiple features, right? You want to create a new to-do. Okay, you know, in the evening, I have to pick up a grocery item, you know, or in the evening, I have to submit my homework or, you know, all these to-do items that you're going to create. And your app is being used by X number of users. You can define that X number of users. Initially, it could be 10. It could go on to 1,000, 10,000, million. You have no clue, right? One of the first features that you need to understand about serverless is that I have no clue at this point how many people are going to use my app, right? And there are multiple features, adding a to-do, marking the to-do as completed, deleting the to-do item, getting all my to-do list, you know, and updating my to-do and everything, right? These are different functions in your application. Now, when I think about this application, the first thing that comes to my mind is, number one, I don't know how many users are going to use it. Number two, I don't know how many will create new tasks versus how many will pull their existing tasks. I have no clue how many will be deleting those tasks. Okay. I have no idea about all these things. Okay. Now, in a PaaS world or in an infrastructure as a service world, if I start spinning up my servers, just imagine where I'll go with this. I will assume that, okay, initially maybe 100 people are going to use this app. Then I go to Amazon or Google. I will say, okay, spin up a server for me. I want my application to run on Windows. Since 100 people will use, yeah, that's fine. I need just one core of CPU or two cores CPU, something. I just need 10 GB space there and everything, right? And I build my application and I host my application on that server. My application became super famous. You guys shared with your friends. It was on social media. Everybody started downloading my application and then started using. But the server that I initially set up was not supposed to handle this. Then what happens? Initially, people will complain in social media saying it's slow. You know, it's not, you know, it's a useless application. We cannot use it and everything. Slowly, people will start trolling about it and then nobody will start using your application. Compare that to the next one, right? Which is platform as a service, right? Where I'll say that, yes, I need a server, but I think I might need a 25 GB. And I will also say scale it for 3 servers, right? That means that every time you hit the 25 GB, scale 3 more servers, okay? And I can also say to the extent of the bandwidth, if my application is pulling this much of data in, that means many people are using it. So spin up new servers like this, right? I can control it to some extent when it comes to a PaaS model. Like I told you, it's about tooling, but I still have to make the decision. I still have to have a good knowledge of how many people will use my application, how many people are going to pull the data and everything so that I can make those decisions and do those things upfront. Now, this is what serverless brings, right? Each of these ones that you are seeing here, if I start building my application in a serverless fashion, I divide my functionality into various functions first. Again, I'll come and I'll explain to you what functions means, how different cloud providers do these functions and everything. But for now, just understand each function as if a small module that you are writing. That module will only do that part of the functionality, and add to do will only take the data from you, from the user, which is probably a to-do title, a to-do description, when it has to be done, and all those things. It will take that, and then it's going to create a to-do item, right? So that is the only functionality this add to-do will do. What is a complete to-do? Once the task is done, somebody is marking it as done, and that's the only functionality this will do. Now, when I architect my solution into these functions, and now I can say, I want these functions to be deployed. That's all I'm saying, right? That apartment has already been built. I'm only saying that if I live in that apartment, as long as I live there, I'm going to pay the money for it. Okay. That's what I'm trying to do here. I do all these functions and I deploy them in a serverless fashion, which is different from a PaaS or a IaaS or a SaaS. I deploy them in a serverless fashion and I say that I will not make those decisions. I will not make the decisions how many users will come, how many servers have to be spinned up, what is going to happen and everything. Let somebody else make the decision for it. I will pay money only if my app is being used. Once I deploy this, if nobody uses my app, I don't pay even a single penny. The first million requests that come, I still don't pay a single penny. From that point onwards, I'm just paying only for what is being used. So now, how did this happen? How did this serverless thing where I'm paying so less has happened is because the Googles, the Amazons, they are making sure that my code runs on the same servers as somebody else's code. They have the infrastructure, the know-how to make sure that they can build these servers where multiple applications can run and multiple applications can be used. And they are the ones who are managing, okay, this particular application, which was running on this small machine, it's getting too many hits. Let's spin it up in a different server. Let's spin up 50 more servers. Let's spin it down to 10 servers. Let's spin it up to 100 more servers. All those decisions are being made by the Amazons, the Googles, the IBMs, the Oracles, who are my public cloud providers. Okay. I hope that should make you guys understand the power that comes with some of these things. Always understand serverless architecture. You need to understand this very clearly, that you are paying only for the time your code is actually running. There's a difference between your code running versus your code getting hosted. There's a huge difference there. Code running means somebody is actually hitting your code and using your application. Code getting hosted means that your website is out there. Nobody is hitting it. It's just up and running. That's what the difference is. In case of the primary one, where your code is running is serverless. You're paying for that millisecond that your code is being used. In the other case, where your website is hosted or your code is hosted somewhere, you are paying every minute that code has been hosted, irrespective of whether somebody is running your code or not. So these are the two major things that you guys have to understand. Again, I'll go back here. So now comes, how are we going to, so I said about functions, right? You know, for now, I think it's enough for you to understand is there is a certain way how you architect these serverless functions, and just think about them as a small piece of functionality that you have to write, which will accept certain input and it will do some, activities in that function. And then it has certain kind of output. Okay. So the languages that you can choose, again, this is where, right? Anybody in the world, if you know C#, Python, Ruby, Java, it doesn't matter. Like I said, you don't decide anything, right? You are only writing your code and saying that I want to deploy this code. The decision is being made by somebody else. You are only going to say that this is my code and I've written this in this programming language. That's it. And somebody else will make the decision like, okay, you know, I think this has to be run on this server and, how much of memory has to be allocated, how much of new servers we have to spin up and how many servers we can spin down. All those decisions are being done by somebody else. As far as your language is concerned, you can choose any one of these languages, and newer languages are being added as we speak. PHP is, I think, you know, some of the other languages are also getting added here, so that you can start building your serverless functions. Okay. So having said that, just one second, let me see. Just trying, I will now, okay, so somebody is asking, how do hackers hack these servers, sir? What is their viewpoint of how to start this hacking? Okay, that's a, in a way, it's a great question, because I don't maintain those servers, right? So now what happens to the security and everything? The easiest answer is you shouldn't care. The reason why you shouldn't care is your serverless applications, right? At that point, they are already hosted onto certain servers where the Googles, the Microsofts, and everybody, they are taking care of the security aspect of it. If your functionality is in such a way that you need, it's a lot more regulated, like for example, healthcare, okay? It's a lot more regulated, or it is financial data, your credit card information or something like that. My first gut feeling would be, I don't think serverless is the right approach for you guys. You know, if it is something that you guys know that it has to be very well protected and everything, you need to look at the options of, are there serverless options for PCI compliance? Are there serverless options for HIPAA compliance and everything, so that you know that your data security wise is all intact and everything. Okay. Serverless computing, which is my next slide, is not the answer for every solution. There are only certain types of applications that you can build on serverless. And, you know, one of them is primarily like any kind of MVP, you know, ideas that you have, or, you know, some things that you know that it has to scale up and scale down pretty fast. And it does not really deal with a lot of secure data and everything, because at the end of the day, your application is running with some other application from some other company, right? It's all shared servers, all the time slicing that I told you about and everything. It is happening on servers where your code is running along with other companies, other people and everything. It's just that the public cloud providers have the know-how to manage each one individually, so that, you know, one is not getting affected by the other. Okay. What is the benefit to the developer paying money to the owners of servers? How developer earns money if he pays money to them? I think that's more of a generic question, I would say. It depends on your application. You know, you need to tell me what is your application and everything. Obviously, if you are going to pay money for the serverless providers, the cloud providers, you need to make your application in such a way that you turn around and you charge your customers. If you know that you end up going to spend $100, 100 rupees on your serverless infrastructure, you must have a plan with your application how to collect that money back from your customers. I think that's more of a generic question. Anyways, so when not to use also, it's very important to understand if your function is a long running function, right? Like for example, right, if you are doing something where it's a back-end job, you know, for example, every 1 minute, I want to make sure, if you are building an application where you have to reach out to all the students, you know, and send them some message or something, you know, like for example, let me, like for example, in your college, one of your professors is basically saying that, hey, every 1 minute, can you please check with the students, and then, you know, only when, you know, whether they are wearing masks or not, you know, and then, you know, you have to check it in such a way that they have to reply back every 1 minute that they have to do this. Okay. So now you're writing an application where you are sending huge amounts of these data in a continuous long running process, where you are sending a message saying that, hey, are you wearing your mask, or are you wearing your mask or something, you know, and then you are running this in a long running process. Serverless applications are not good for that. You will end up spending more money than a PaaS application. The reason is your code is continuously running. There is no stop for it, right? So obviously the serverless infrastructure thinks that too many people are hitting this, you know, too much of server resources are being used. So it automatically spins up your code into multiple servers and everything so that it needs to handle the data. So that is why serverless computing or serverless processes are not good for long running things. It should be something. The typical scenario is if you go to Amazon.com, right, or Amazon.in, and you order a product, okay, and you click on, you enter your credit card information, and you click on, pay. Okay, after 5 minutes, you get an email, right, saying that okay, your order has been placed. Okay, if you really think about how the steps would have gone. Since the credit card payment and everything is a very secured mechanism, it would have been some kind of pass solution, something that is running all the time because, that's a very secured information that you need to hold. But once that is done, once a credit card payment has been done, okay, it would have triggered something on the serverless side where all it has to do is it takes an email ID and it sends an email, right? A small thing, right? I don't know as an Amazon.com developer whether today million users will use that pay functionality or 100 million will use it, right? So I don't know whether a million emails will go or 100 email will go, okay? So that is why I think it's very important for you to understand that is when you're doing these functions, ask yourself some of these basic questions. Is it a long running process? Will it keep on running every minute, every second that I will end up spending more money compared to a pass? Because it is running so many times, those serverless frameworks will make some assumptions. Okay, it's being running continuously, so maybe it's getting hit by many users. Let me spin up more servers so that I can make sure that this is running for a longer period of time. But, you know, so you need to be very careful with that. Legacy applications. Legacy means old applications. You know, some applications that have been built 10, 15 years back, right? If you were to, for example, if something was built, I don't know, in VB6 or old applications in, 2000 or 2005, you know, some application has been built. And now you want to put that into a serverless framework, just copy pasting that code and then putting into serverless functions will not help the cause at all. You know, those legacy applications have to be completely re-architectured. You know, those old applications have to be re-architectured in such a way that you can actually put them in a serverless fashion and then, you know, divide them into functions and do that. So if you are thinking of a legacy applications and thinking about serverless, my suggestion would be, you have to do a lot of discovery before you even take the decision as to going into a serverless functionality. The next thing is the vendor lock-in. At your level, maybe you might think it's not a big deal. Vendor lock-in means if I deploy my application to Microsoft Azure or Amazon Web Services or to Google, I'm stuck with that company forever. Okay. So if I write my function and I deploy it to Google Functions, for example, okay, that's it. You know, my application is running there. Tomorrow, if I have to spin that and then put it onto Microsoft or to Amazon or something, there is still a certain amount of work that is still needed for you to do that. You might think that that's not a big deal, but today almost every organization will talk about this where they want to do multi-cloud. You know, that means I don't want my application to be stuck with Amazon, because I don't know how many of you know, like a month or two back, some of the Amazon, servers, they came down, lots of applications were not running and everything, right? So the outlook of many organizations today is, how do I make sure that my application is running in Amazon and also parts of it are running in Microsoft Azure or Google Functions, just in case if Amazon in the South India is done, I know that is down, you know, I know that something else is picking up from some other cloud provider or something. So this vendor lock-in is a huge problem for companies that they are trying to solve by having a multi-cloud strategy. So in these are the cases, and there are a whole list of other things also where serverless computing might not be a good thing to go for. So the important things that you guys have to really understand here is when you are thinking about serverless is think about first and foremost thing, can I predict? Can I predict how many users are going to come? If I can predict that this is exactly the number of users, for example, I am building an application for your college. I know exactly how many students are in your college, right? It could be in that range. Then I can say maybe pass, you know, I will go for a platform as a service model, build it out there because I know exactly how many people are going to use it and everything. And only this college will be the only ones who has to use this application, right? That would be the first question I'll ask myself. The second one I'll ask myself is, does this have anything that is related to HIPAA compliance or PCI, credit card information and everything that I don't want my code to be running on a server that I myself don't know if it has all the right things to keep my data secure. I wouldn't do that also in serverless computing unless there is an option where I know that these serverless servers are built primarily for that kind of a HIPAA compliance or PCI compliance or something. And that is where probably private cloud might be very helpful, where we can still build the serverless infrastructure in a private cloud, which probably could be out of scope for this session. The next thing that I would probably ask myself is this a long running process? Is this going to be something that will all the time, it will be running and running and running? That it's going to the serverless framework is just going to spin up so many more servers that I will actually be paying more money than a PaaS solution. Okay, so these would be at least some of the major questions that I would think that people will have to consider before actually building a serverless application. Having said all this, I would like to hear from you guys, in the chat or after this call, think about what would be the next serverless application that you guys can think about that you can build. And then Microsoft Azure gives free 30 days worth of, 30 days. And I don't know there, but here we get like $200 worth of Azure services that you can use. So try to build a serverless application there. Or Amazon, same thing. Like you saw, right? 1 million requests free of cost. You don't need to pay. Just spin up a Amazon serverless Lambda function or something and see if you can spin it up something, put it out there and see how it works. Okay. So that would be one thing that I would surely suggest is as you're going in your cloud computing journey or learning any newer technology, make sure that you are actually writing code and actually deploying, walk through all the steps, before you know that whether this is the right thing or not, because there is only so much anybody like me or your lecturers or whoever it is can actually explain to you. But until and unless you actually try it out, you wouldn't really see how things would work. Okay. So at this point, I will go through some of these chat questions and then I'll try to answer some of these. But I'll also leave my email IDs here for anybody to note them down. If you want to reach out to me personally, the bottom one, that's my personal email address. You can reach out to me there. If you guys want to apply for internship, anybody who is in this session, I just wanted to lay it out there, we do have, free lunches, that means that, we do internships and we do paid internships with a lot of students from various colleges. So if you guys are interested in working on an IoT project or a AR VR project or building web applications, cloud solutions, any of those projects, we are very proud of our internship program in terms of the opportunity that we create. We actually put you on a real-time project working with real customers and on a real-time solution. And, it's going to be a great experience. So if any one of you guys are interested, please email me your information to talent@encompassbusiness.com and we can surely consider an internship. Okay. I'll take some time here to Anuradha, we still have some time, or did I already go over time?
Answer the questions, Ramana. There are some questions while you looking questions asked by students. Some people have texted me privately, so
okay.
Want to address those questions meanwhile while you look those questions. Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So
some have asked the question of what are the components inside the server. So the server is actually hardware, as sir has mentioned. When it is handling data like instant data, they're really huge. Like as much as the servers are all big buildings called data centers, which are as big as college or so. It is asked, can we think these servers will be, the cloud things will be hosted somewhere in the space? Okay, definitely over a period of time we can see it. But at the moment they are have come innovatively, and some servers or data centers are established under the water, in the sea. So Microsoft has established a very big data center inside the sea, and so the component, see the big outside server. There will be inside operating systems. There will be software. Say my application .NET, your application need Java, say. So they will be hosting all those actually. So they will be hosting a big server. In that server, they will make partition. They will host .NET for me. They will host Java for you. So there will be lots of activities inside. Apart from the operating system, there will be the framework, software frameworks. Over it, your software will be launched. Okay, so these are the different components, and who is going to pay is a question that students are not able to understand. So here is where .me, you know, right? We are launching an application from Blackbuck for all of you to access it. If I ask you, because most cloud or serverless computing, you pay to Amazon, you know, will you keep on every month to Amazon? You won't do, because I am hosting blackbuck.me. I am the application owner of blackbuck.me. That app, I have to pay. I can't ask you to pay. So my customers don't pay. I have to pay. And later I will see 2000 is not working from me. Maybe I have to charge 2100 from the student. I will have to think my models. So you don't, the customers pay for it. You can't open it up and say to everyone, okay, all students pay to Amazon. I can't say that. So I have to pay. Making the application, those people have to pay. Okay. And another question. Okay. We are not able to access content of other countries in sometimes. Will serverless computing help view other world's content? So it won't, that's again the control of the application. Like blackbuck.me, I put the control saying that I don't want my application to be available in Australia. I put like that condition. That's why you're not able to see. Wherever I'm hosting, whether it is serverless or whatever, I am putting a condition saying that I don't want my application blackbuck.me to be viewed in Australia. So they are not able to view. It is nothing to do with your serverless computing. Who all can access my data in a serverless system? That is, you have to decide. So I will decide whoever is member of Center of Excellence can access my application. That is, that's me to decide. I'm the application owner. Serverless is server, data, storage. I'm managing internally. Okay, I can't buy a server which is costing me crores and crores of rupees. I don't want to buy. So I'll ask Amazon or Microsoft Azure or somebody, can you please host? I'll just pay rent for you. I'm just paying rent. That's what I'll tell to Amazon or somebody. So that's the reason. It is I decide. My application, I decide. They are just hosting for me. They're hosting all my applications, data, whatever junk memes you post, everything. They are looking into it. So, you know, they are not bothered about what they're posting, who we should give. I will tell them. Only authorized people who I authorize should be able to see. Others should not be seeing. That is what I will tell. And this is a great, great learning for me also, because what happened is for blackbuck.me application, which we have to host, I have to pay. We took in Microsoft Azure. We took all the cloud, everything in Microsoft Azure. So from the time of development starting itself, I have to pay 25,000 per month though nobody is using. I'm just using for developing purpose. I'm developing, but still I have to pay 25,000 rupees per month to Microsoft Azure, though no one is using. Now serverless computing is so good that while developing, I don't need to pay. Only if you start using my customers, that is the students, start using, then only Azure will charge when I use serverless computing. Otherwise, I'll have to keep paying, though I'm not using. Okay, that's another question people have asked. After paying the amount, how will I know about the details about central? Okay. There is some voice disturbance from me. I'm sorry, guys. Risk factors, sir has mentioned, right? There are certain government websites also pay for servers. They buy, actually government buys usually. They are still not in cloud. At least in India, they are not in cloud. They buy their own servers. Okay, what about the risk factor in serverless? Serverless has its own risks. As I said, now my entire blackbuck.me application we have hosted in Azure. So I should live with Azure forever. I am logged in with Azure. Okay, so there are certain risks associated with serverless, but you will have to decide whether you want to take that risk or not. Okay. If you can decide audience, what audience can see your content, then how it's not protected? Can you explain that? Okay, we decide audience, how audience can see, but sometimes, you know, the controls, everything is software, right? The controls are sometimes loose. But as sir has mentioned, these are biggies, Amazon or Google or Microsoft, they are biggies. They take very strong measures that they can actually retain to whatever we are deciding as the audience. They take all the measures, but sometimes there can be some, it is like police and thief, right? Police makes all the measures. You do not know when the thief comes from where. When the thief comes, then the police will know, okay, this guy is doing like this, so let me put one more control. So as many controls they put, there will be a hacker who will get hold of some small thing somewhere. Okay, so you will also have classes if you are interested. I see a lot of interest from the students on hacking and how to improve security. There are cybersecurity projects that you can do as you go forward. Okay. Okay, all right. That's from me to questions to me, Ramna. Thank you for bearing with me. Okay.
No. That actually, you were like so good. You know, I think teaching is an inborn thing. It's really amazing how you have put that. And thank you so much. Yeah. On my side, can you guys hear me?
There is disturbance, Ramna. For some reason, it is.
How about now?
You go on.
From my side, you know, I don't see much questions here. I think most of it you have answered. Guys, again, you know, somebody was asking what is my email. The one at the bottom, Ramana, Ramana, nncompassbusiness.com. It is Encompass with only one S. That's my email address. If you want to reach out to me, asking me any further information on this topic, if you want to apply for the internship, please send out an email to talent@encompassbusiness.com and provide us more information about you, which college, which year, what are you doing and everything. That would help us in seeing, you know, who is the best candidate for us to reach out and go from there. Almost all the internships that we have done till date have been, you know, absolutely successful for the students and for us, primarily because we put them on real-time projects, like I told before, right? You know, and if you can give full time to the internship, well and good. Even if it is part time, also that's also fine. Okay. Are you there? You guys cannot hear me?
There is a lot of disturbance, Ramna. Somehow there is kind of not clear. Voice is not clear for reason, but I can't do much about it.
It could be very well that my kids might have got up and then it could be Netflix or something, or they would have started. But were you guys able to hear me from the beginning, or was I just talking to myself?
No, just now, after I spoke, it is showing this problem. So student sir was mentioning about internship. Do not flood his inbox. If you are in third year, you will be able to understand a lot of these concepts. And sir is working in deep technology area. So it is good if you, I will tell you, if you are in the third, please write to hr@theblackbucks.com. You can put hr@theblackbucks.com. So we actually do some kind of screening to sir and then send profiles. But if you are in third year, do consider this, because that's such a great area and a great gesture from sir. So you can directly to him. But if you are in third year, to him. Otherwise, for second years will not probably to do much about it. So you can get. Please consider or like. Yeah, we will share. We will share recording of the class.
Okay. Perfect. Again, thank you, everyone. It's been a great honor, great pleasure speaking to all of you. If I had gone over most of you guys as I was speaking at the beginning, I'm extremely sorry. Can you hear me at least now when I'm saying thank you?
Right, still kind of robotic voice that's coming. Okay, students, please feel back, because sir has taken time. Let's provide back of what you think and how useful it is, so that it will be really nice for him to understand how well that he has taken out from his personal time. It has helped you. Okay, that's what will make him happy. Okay, so kindly fill the feedback and I'll send the feedback to you. Thank you so much, Ramna, for your time. You have almost 2 hours. Session. I'm sure you have for preparing this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Really an honor to be here. Thanks. Bye.